is pure, innocent, Son of God, Son of Man, died at the hands of wicked men, and for the life of others. Because if he does not, there is no hope. There is no hope. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. If Jesus had not died, and I mean a man by the name of Jesus the Christ, had he not died, salvation could not be had by anybody in any dispensation at any time. It would not make a difference. All of time, all of history, everything points to the success of that cross and the resurrection. If that did not take place, it's over for everybody. As that terrible week began, the person that God said was the only person who could do this, listen, so we find out here Jesus Christ was lifted up between heaven and earth. Before Jesus ever got to the cross, what a lot of people do not understand. You think that he just one day he went before Herod and there he was on the cross. Oh, no. So much took place before he ever got to the cross. I want you to follow me as briefly as I can, but I want to point out some things to you about what all happened, how much took place, and more. I will not be able to describe it to satisfy anybody, especially myself, or the cause of Christ, but I will do what I can. Go to Matthew chapter number 26. I'm sorry, I didn't read Romans. Matthew chapter number 26. Before Jesus ever got to the cross, you must understand by Old Testament example, illustration, and prophecy, Jesus had to be set aside and examined for 4 days. And the Jews coming out of Egypt, they had to choose a lamb, an innocent lamb in the prime of life, and set it aside and examine it for 4 days. Jesus, our lamb in the New Testament, everybody's lamb, but actual in the New Testament, was set aside and examined for 4 days. And so here's what we find out in Matthew chapter number 26. I want you to look at verse number 36. Matthew 26, verse 36. Then cometh Jesus with them to a place called Gethsemane, and said unto his disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that's James and John, and beheld and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little farther and fell upon his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he came unto his disciples and findeth them asleep. And saith unto Peter, what, could thou not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again a second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. Verse 43, and he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were very heavy. And he went, and he left them, and went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. He cometh, then cometh he to his disciples, and saith unto them, sleep on now, take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Arise, let us be gone. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. And we go on from there. Jesus had already been up all that day. You know the story. This was the night of what we refer to as the Last Supper. This is also when they were already celebrating Passover that week. And we come to find out that while this was going on, this is going to be a long week for Jesus Christ. A long week. He was up early that morning, and the day, all that night, now we find him in the garden praying at least 3 hours that we know of. We know that after the dinner, then he instituted the Lord's Supper. They also had that same night, if we put all these things together, he showed them the washing of the disciples' feet. He showed him all these things, and then they went out to the garden. As they sang and hymn going out to the garden, they went that night to Gethsemane, and there they were. They were praying, my mom said they were praying, and for at least want you to go to chapter 26, verse 56. Verse 56. Now here's what we find. The Bible said, then all the disciples forsook him and fled. So as the day is going on, started off very early in the morning. It's been a long, busy day. A lot of teaching, a lot of fellowship, a lot of moving here and there. All these things are being set up. Then they go out and they begin to pray for 3 hours. The disciples are flat worn out. Jesus has been up all day. He's been helping everybody, instituting things, teaching very, very important last sermons and subjects, if you would, to his disciples. As he's getting ready to go away, he's going to go to his father. And so he, that night in prayer, we come to find out Judas comes that night. He's betrayed by Judas into the hands of the Romans, or sinners, as Jesus said. And now we come to find out what that happened. You ready for this? His disciples run away. He said, well, they were afraid. His disciples ran away. They all left him. In an hour of need, he said, well, some followed up. Yes, afar off. That's like people said, right behind you, preacher. You only got about 400 miles back here somewhere. But you have to understand, this was a long, long night to endure. Then the religious leaders and those in authority brought false accusation. False accusation. They couldn't get any two people to lie the same. Sounds like the Democrats. Couldn't get two people to... I'm sorry, did I just say that? And so what he did, they finally found two people to finally mask up their lie. And no pun intended, trumped up charge. Go to chapter 26, look at verse number 59. Is that season yet? Verse number 59. Now the chief priests and elders and all the council sought false witnesses. They didn't have any evidence. They were looking for something. There was nothing coming. This sounds awfully familiar, does it not? Now he's keep bringing up worldly stuff. We're talking about our lovely Savior. But sought false witnesses against Jesus to put him to death. They wanted him out of the way. He interrupted their whole life, their whole lifestyle, their whole belief system, everything they stood for. They had to get him out of the way. We have to lie about this. We're going to do it. But we've got to find some people to lie for us. So watch what he says. But, verse 60, but found none. Yea, though many false witnesses came, yet found they none. At the last, there came two witnesses and said, this fellow said, I am it. Now watch, look how bad this is. Look at the wickedness of this statement. This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days. Now, that's not worth killing somebody in the right way. You see, they weren't looking for overwhelming evidence. They weren't looking for evidence. They weren't for anything to say, there is right there. That's what they said. Do we need to say more? Yes, I wish you would. Why? Because you don't have anything else. And so we find out here, go down to verse number 62. And the high priest said unto him, answerest thou nothing? What is it which these witnesses witness against thee? Jesus held his peace. Boy, that's hard to do, isn't it? People are lying and accusing and everybody's in a rage. Everybody's foaming at the mouth, and you just stay there and take it. You think it's easier to stay here and prove yourself. It's not. This is the harder thing to do. But Jesus held his peace, and the high priest answered and said unto him, I adjure thee. What a hypocrite. By the living God, that thou tellest us whether thou be Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said unto him, thou hast said. Nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest rent his clothes and said, he hath spoken blasphemy. What further need have we of witnesses? You didn't want to be here. Behold, now we have heard his blasphemy. And what think ye? They answered and said, he is guilty of death. He's guilty of death. I want you to not take any other Bible. Look at what was just said and the absolute proof and wickedness that Jesus was accused of, and tell me why you thought he was worthy of death. If we go to this, if we're looking for things, if we keep setting the law to the side, I'm not preaching politics, I know that's where your mind is. Your mind's kind of going there too, but you have to understand, when you set the law to the side, now comes in personality and feelings and emotions, which are illogical and will not hold truth. Jesus just said that, you know why I didn't argue back? Several reasons. One is what they're going to do. Number two, Jesus came to die. So whether they knew it or not, this is playing right into the hands of God Almighty. All things do. So we find out here these people people alive, they gathered around Jesus Christ like a mob. We can get a picture of that somewhere. And they beat him with their fists, and then they spit on him. Boy, when you spit on somebody in this state, that was the highest form of humiliation and disgust you could possibly put on a person, was to contempt, to spit on them. Look at verse number 67 of chapter 26. 67. Then did they spit not on him in his face and buffeted him. That means they hit him with their fist. People look the word up, that's what it means, okay? And then it says this, and others smote him with a buffet. Other people went by and slapped him. Other people hit him with a fist. People were spitting on him. I'm talking about your Savior. And you say, well, maybe he was deserving of it. I just read you the account of the wicked laws that he broke. This was trumped up charge. This was nothing but hype. This was we need to get this guy out of the way so we can go ahead and live our pharisaical life and act like we're better than everybody else. Boy, it really sounds like a Democrat study. And so this is what we need to do. Now, if you're a Democrat, I pray that you get saved. Peter denied him late that night. Jesus is in court, if you would. And he's standing there, and Peter, you know the story, he's outside it. He followed afar off, and sure enough, all these things begin to happen. Late that night, Jesus is being questioned and beaten. He's had no sleep all that day, since early that morning, all that night, they kept him up. They kept him up. He had no food, no water, and the next morning, they tied him up and took him over to see Pilate. I'm not going to ask you to turn there, but in Matthew 27, 1 and 2, you can see that. Found out that he belonged to him, or that they took him from the religious leaders and took him over to Pilate and tried to force an issue with a higher civil authority that he needed to destroy Jesus. We come to find out later on, he said this, look, that's up to you. That is not up to me. I'm washing my hands this whole thing. Because he is an innocent man. The authority said he's an innocent man. You have no reason to crucify this guy. But public opinion swayed judicial ruling. So what do we find here? After being questioned and accused, Jesus said nothing to defend himself. This is the reason that he came. In Isaiah chapter 53, in verse number 7, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. That's Old Testament verifying who Jesus was and what he said in the New Testament, word for word. It's called prophecy of the Lord Jesus Christ. Though Jesus is God while on this earth, he held all the same things that you do in your physical human body except sin. You know what that means? He thirsted. He hurt. He bruised. He bled. He cried. He felt things. He suffered. All these things Jesus had, he sweated. And just like everybody else, listen to me very carefully. Everybody watched. Everybody heard. Everybody was represented that day in that crowd somewhere. I'll show you. Where do you fit in that crowd today? I'll explain in a minute. God gave the people as a whole one last chance. Even in all of this examination, give you one last chance. So one of the governors or kings brought out Barabbas, already knowing submission he's guilty of. Already knowing, I mean, guilt, not guilty of charge, guilty of trying to overthrow the Roman government. So they brought him out and caused the Jews a lot of problems because of that guy right there. And they brought out Jesus Christ, figuring they will choose him over this guy. This guy's a scumbag here. I mean, he's totally wrong in everything he's doing. According to law, this really is an innocent man. And, you know, they envy him. They're jealous of him. That's why they want to get rid of him. So he brought them both out and said, choose him. Which one? Barabbas or Jesus? You won't blame him. He chose Barabbas. They chose Barabbas, and then he turned around and said, what has he done? Why do you want to kill this guy so badly? You ever notice sometimes when we get a mob mentality, facts go right out the window? You ever notice that? That doesn't make any difference. He needs to be destroyed. Why? Because. That's always a good reason right there. Because. Listen, everybody was there. So I want you to go. It wasn't just enough that they chose Barabbas and refused Jesus. Then they tacked on, crucify him. That's what I'm saying. Okay, don't put him in jail. Put him in nothing, sir. We're not going to kill him. We're not going to kill him. But on that day, they get him saved. They put him in jail, get rid of him, excommunicate him. No, they said, crucify him. Crucify him. So they didn't just pick Barabbas. They wanted Jesus crucified. Jesus had been up in a jail for almost 4 days. No sleep. Bleeding. Bruised. Hungry. Thirsty. Pilate, the governor, turns Jesus over to a whole Roman band of soldiers. They didn't have females in the military back in those days. They were not kind. These people were used to conquering the world. And they did it by force. You have to understand, I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 27, verse 27. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall. He hasn't been speaking there. And gathered around him the whole band of soldiers, and they stricken. Oh, I wish Christians knew the way that God feels about nakedness. There's only one time God ever looked upon nakedness and saw the pureness of it all, and that was Adam and Eve in the garden, because there was no sin of any kind in their nature whatsoever. But the little child, the little girl, is normal. But you don't feel that way now. God despises nakedness. Nakedness is not an absence of all clothing. It's a nakedness is an absence of clothing in certain areas, not covering yourself properly. So here's what we have here in verse number 28. And they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, twisted a vine of thorns in a circle, they put it upon his head and a reed in his hand like a scepter. It's just a big stick. And they bowed the knee to him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And here we go again. And they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him in the head. Verse 31. And after that, they mocked him. And they making fun, stripped him down, put on a robe that maybe a king would might wear. We'll put a stick in your hand, act like it's your scepter. We'll get a crown of thorns and put it in your head. And, oh, he's a king! And they're mocking and making fun while he's standing there with the spittle and the blood dripping down off his body through the robe that he has on. And then they decide, how stripping down, he put on his own rags, put all that back on him. All this taking place before he even gets there. They strip his clothes off, they embarrass him, they mock him, put on a mock crown. They do all these things, making fun of his supposed kingship. And he opened not his mouth. Sometimes we defend ourselves. As they laugh and mock and spit and point, then they become angry, and for the second time they spit on him, we just read, and they take a club and beat him in the head with it, while Jesus' face is oozing with spittle, while his beard has been pulled out. I would love, who has a beard in it? I would love to demonstrate this one. You have no idea. Blood pouring from his head. Blood was pouring. to. Go to Psalm chapter 22. Go down to verse number 13, please. Psalm 22, verse number 13. This is a prophecy concerning Jesus Christ and his crucifixion. Verse 13, they gape upon me with their mouth. He's hanging down and they go by like this. They can't believe what they're looking at. They're gaping. And he says this. It says that verse number 13, they gape on me as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. Thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me about. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierce my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, for they look and stare upon me. They part my garment among them, and cast lots for gambling over the lifespan that he had on this earth at all, other than friendships and things like that, was a robe. While he's dying, they're gambling on who's going to get next, so they don't have to tear it all apart. We find out here, everybody was there that day. Everybody watched. Everybody heard. Everybody is represented in this crowd somewhere. I'm going to ask you again. Today, everybody in this room fits into this crowd somewhere, and I'll even show you where the Bible points out everybody in the world in this crowd. By the crowd. Watch what it says. In Luke chapter 23, we're going to read through verses 34 through 43. Our text verse, but look at verse number 35. Look how it starts off. And the people stood beholding. Now, please do not go on and do your own Bible study. Okay? The people, that's a common people, spectators, they just stood there. They didn't say anything, they didn't do anything, they just stood there. Is this what you do? Is this you today? How many times have you heard this kind of a sermon? How many times have you visualized this kind of a picture? How many times have you, if you would, been a part of the people of this crowd, yet you still do not believe? You still are not convinced? You still have not accepted? You still have not stepped forward to be saved or to be identified with that man that's hanging on the cross for the sins of the whole world? The Bible said, and the people stood beholding. They just watched. They didn't do anything. They just absolutely watched. May I ask you, where do you fit in today? Is that you? How many times are you going to hear a gospel message? How many times is God, through a friend or picking up a Bible or a tract somewhere, reminding you of what Jesus Christ did for you, and yet you're basically just a spectator, just standing there watching the whole thing, letting it pass on as though it really doesn't concern you? And the people, the Bible says, stood beholding, made no move, stood right there, did not get involved, did nothing to help, but thinking, he said, well, I didn't do anything against it. Do you know sometimes when you do not stand for something, you're against it? Not always, but sometimes. For example, I'm drowning. And you tell people, you're standing there, you're saying, I didn't put my foot on his head. I know what you need to hear. Number two, verse number 35. So first of all, the people stood beholding. Look at number two. Number two, verse 35. And the elders, what did they do? They divided him. I love looking up definition of words because it helps to describe what's going on. It means to sneer outright. Next question. What does sneer mean? That's a good point. If I look that one up, it says to draw the face into a grin or a grimace. You see people again. You got anything? Or to grimace about something? It means to curl the lip in a scornful or contemptuous manner by the expression of the face. They didn't say anything. Their facial expressions were speaking loud enough. We're talking here about the rulers expressing the authorities and the rulers and those in position sneered. No, don't understand. They weren't speaking out loud, but their face was sure talking a whole bunch. They were actually being read of everybody else. You've seen it before. Everybody's looking at the president. And everybody's happy you see somebody got looking. That's a sneer. That's a sneer. That's what he's talking about. You're basically with your facial expression saying, I do not approve. I do not approve. I will not accept this. Scornful, contemptuous grimace. Perhaps a wagging of the head. That kind of a thing. You said, I never said anything. No, you said plenty without opening your mouth. So we find out here again, maybe this is you. Maybe this is you. You're standing there. This is you. Everyone that was represented in the crowd this day, you didn't openly say anything, but your facial expressions for anybody that's paying attention. That's why it's so important, the way you make your face work. You said, I didn't mean it that way. That's the way they took it. Because you said to the whole time like it. Shame himself if you be Christ, the chosen of God. That's it. That's all. That's what they did. Now, look, if you were to visit verse 36 through 37. So we talk about the people, we talked about the rulers, now we're going to talk about the military. Watch what happens here. The soldiers, the Bible says, also mocked him, verse 36. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. This is done with emphasis. I don't say the Greek word, but it's emphasis. It means to jeer, not to sneer, but to jeer. What it means is to speak or shout ridiculing. To speak or shout. See, these are soldiers. These are tough guys. These are men's men. These are guys who stand on their own 2 feet and pop their shoulders back. Hey, friend, tell you what I believe. That's what they were doing right here. This is the strong self, the sword type, the rugged type. Those who don't need anybody to help them, speaking openly. Yeah, I think that's the Christ guy. Hey, don't you say, don't they say to shout? They're jeering, out loud, speaking, not afraid. They're not afraid of rebel. They're not afraid of anybody talking about them and what they have to say. You openly mock Christ? What he did for you? Do you? He said, Christianity is for sissies. That's what you tell people. It's for the weak. Weak and feeble people. You mean something? I don't need something like that. Soldiers are represented being strong. See, you don't blaspheme, or maybe you don't curse his name. You just have no need of his help. And you tell other people that too. That's what soldiers do. Actually, soldiers are primed that way. You can do this. Don't give in. Don't give up. You'll fight your way through. You don't need others' help. Do it on your own. You can do this. That's what they do. And so you find out there, these people are simply emphasis. They have no qualms about telling other people why I don't need that Jesus. And I don't know why you do it, unless you're weak. They're not afraid to say that at all. They'll say it out loud. They're absolutely wrong, but they'll say it out loud. How many times have you been witness to? How many times have you been witness to? By the way, everybody's represented here this day. People, the rulers, the soldiers. How many times have you heard or seen or read this about Jesus Christ? And yet you still tell other people how you're making it without him. How you're doing okay and don't really need Jesus. You're still telling people these things. He can't even help himself. How in the world are you supposed to help me if I can't? This is the way a soldier's mentality. Everybody watched. Everybody heard. Everybody was represented this day in the crowd. I'm simply asking you, where do you fit in today? Is this you? Go to verse number 39. And a superscription also was written, verse 39, and one of the malefactors, which him, saying, "If thou be the Christ, save thyself and us." Railed on him, that means to vilify, to defame him, to reject as being evil. I got a thief hanging here, railing on the guy next to him, telling how unworthy and how he's a liar and how I'll never believe in you. Really, is that the time to do that? You know, we always say when a person hits the bottom, they'll turn around. I know people who hit the bottom, they turn around. I know it got so bad they couldn't hardly continue to even live, and they didn't turn around. Yet, instead, this man's hanging on the cross. He's about ready to die. And if he doesn't die on his own, they're going to come by with a huge mallet and break the femur bones in his leg. So he has to hang and drown in his own bodily foot. He's getting ready to die. And he looks over at this person that many people have given evidence to and testimony to that he is the Christ and that he can't save. And the only thing that he's doing here, he is railing on him while hanging on the cross, looking over here at this guy, close enough to hear the blood splattering on the ground, to hear him heaving, to gasping for breath, to seeing the stew and the tears coming down his face. And if you want to rail on him, do you understand, my dear friend, the problems that you have and the position that you are in? You could die at any moment, one step away from going into hell itself. And the Savior said, but how often are you going to continue to rail on Jesus Christ as though I'll make it on my own? Probably get much worse. If thou be the Christ. You know what he's saying? You have to be Christ. You have to be Christ. Come on, who are you trying to find? Okay, get off here. Yes, thank you. Deriding him. You've heard people say, I've heard him say that. I think they put out a movie where he had an affair with Mary Magdalene. That is the most blasphemous, wicked thing a person can come up with. Hollywood has never put out a movie that describes anything properly. You've heard people say people had proven his claims were a lie. And you just go on that. Oh, really? Oh, how about that? Then you use this fact. He's no different than Buddha or Ali or Pope or Mary or any of the rest of them. Do you know what Jesus said? He's a fake. He's no different than anybody else that's been in this world. You see, this thief, he deserved what he was going to do. He's a thief. And these days, thieves die. By the way, you wouldn't stop favoring him. I promise you, they won't feel like doing anything. If you're looking around for someone to help you snowflake, to feel better about what you think, it's not this crowd. Yet you turn. He turned to the only person and poisoned the very person next to him, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He's like, I didn't know that. That's somebody else you've got. It's Jesus Christ, the Savior. He made him out to be something evil. Everybody was there that day. Everybody's represented. Everybody heard it. Everybody saw it. Everybody was represented. I'm just asking you, where do you fit in this plan? Everybody fits in here somewhere. He's like, I'm not a soldier. Okay, that's not you. I'm not a ruler. Okay, that's not you. Tell me you're not a king. You just don't stand there and do nothing. Just watch the whole thing go right on by you. Or perhaps you're one of these people that are guilty as guilty can be, and yet you're still deflecting everything from you. And what about him? This guy's a liar. Boy, he's for the years. If you're the Son of God. And just mocking and deriding and actually accusing him of being a liar. You know, my Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verse number 12 and 13, I believe it is. It is that chapter, I'm just not sure the verses. That if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as Savior, you are calling God a liar because you do not believe the truth that God gave of his Son. You're not saved, and you are calling God a liar. You're saying, I don't believe the story that Jesus gave. Is there anybody that wanted to save? Jesus came to die for sinners, of which we all are. ever voluntarily saying, I don't believe the story. In 1 John chapter 5, it is saying, you call God a liar. He said, I've never said that. By your actions and dismissal of not receiving Christ as Savior, you are calling God Almighty a liar concerning His only begotten Son. That's pretty bad sin, folks. Number 5. I want you to notice, go back to chapter number 24 and verse number 40. Chapter 23, verse number 40. But the other entering rebuked him. Now you are aware. Now these aren't the only three people that were in Christ like this. Thousands and thousands of people dying of crucifixion. One of those horrible deaths that man has ever come up with. It's not the fastest, it's not the most terrible person part, it's the way that person died. Answering, rebuked him, saying, dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same kind? And John has taken, we're dying too. What's the matter with you? What are you talking about? We're condemned, he's condemned. What are you railing on him for? Watch what he says. And we indeed justly. We're dying for right reasons. But this man, watch what he says here. This guy knew this. For we receive the due reward of our deeds. Folks, look, you steal somebody, I'll lock you up. You lie, you ought to be punished. Jesus didn't do any of that. And he's dying on the cross. You know why? For you. And the guy, the thief here, looks over and says, you're not the Christ. You're deserving this as we are. The thief on the other side defends him and yields to Jesus Christ and who he is. Look, can't trust a drug addict. Can't trust a liar. By the way, there's two things that came in. I lived with 9 junkies one time. And they rip you off. They call it a junk friendship. They'll lie to you, they'll promise you a little bit, you steal a little from them. And they beg you with tears to forgive them, they couldn't help themselves. I got a thief dying. Ridiculing a guy evidently he don't know much about. And I got a thief over here looking at that thief and saying, what's the matter with you? You know we're getting exactly what we deserve. Boy, that's all right to hear somebody who's guilty or saying, I deserve what's happening to me. Even Christians won't hardly do that anymore. We make every excuse on why we don't deserve what's going on. That's really not our fault. We didn't mean to do it on purpose. I hope you wouldn't do it on purpose. But watch what happens here. And he said, but the other thief answering. You see, he too had heard. He too had watched. He too had been a part of this crowd. Somewhere he'd come up with this idea and the fact that this man's innocent. Now, if he just showed up one day, how would he know that? Because he had heard. Because he had seen. He might have been in other crowds where he watched and heard Jesus teaching and the things that he did and how he loved people. I don't know, but he found it out somewhere. Nobody just shows up and says, he's a great guy right there. Nobody knows that. You have to understand here, he did not just stare and do nothing. This thief on the cross watched the whole thing. He didn't just, if you would like the other people, stare and do nothing. He did not just draw up the face with contempt and show that out of the way. He didn't do that. The guy's hanging on the cross. He's guilty of his sin. He's guilty of the whole thing. He did not shout ridiculing, scoffing remarks. He didn't do that. Did not blaspheme and make Jesus out to be something evil. This is strange. Even while dying, and the proof was that he was guilty, he was honest. He said, we justly say something about it. He was honest and going to say something about it. By the way, Jesus didn't say anything. I wonder what was going through Jesus' mind as his thought processes were going. You think of that? Even while he's suffering all of that, this comes right to you. I mean, what would you do? Really? When you have no hope for another place for that time? That's not right. This guy is not just defending, he's not defending Jesus. He's confessing his wrath. This guy over here. This guy should be identified with him as both thieves, they're both in the same situation, and both of them have Jesus right there. Listen to me very carefully. Look at verse number 41. He confessed his sin. He said, we indeed justly. You know what he's saying? Look, mate, we're sinners. We messed up, and you know we messed up. He's confessing. And it amazes me, people that you talk to on somebody, or people in your family, whatever the case is. Seems like the more you press to help them understand what they're guilty of, the more they reject it. They just don't want to hear it. They just don't like it. Because in our heads, we've been convinced if I do enough good, that will make me gooder. And if I'm gooder enough, then maybe God will let me go to heaven. It doesn't work that way. It does not work. Both of these guys were dying because they were thieves. They stole stuff from people, maybe all their life, and finally got caught. Maybe had a rat seat that long, and finally somebody caught them. And it happened to be on the same day that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on a hill for everybody, and these two guys were right there with him. How would you like to go down in history as Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and two thieves? And you're one of those guys. Well, the guy over here that threw stuff in his teeth while he was dying, I don't want to be him. Because that man right now is in hell and has been for about 2,000 years. What an opportunity for this guy. All he did was recognize a couple of absolute facts. This guy's innocent. He's the Son of God. I mean, you've heard the stories. You've heard the stories. You've read your Bible. You've seen it in some of your friends. You know how people's lives have been turned around. You watched the whole thing. But this guy's innocent. He's confessing that I'm getting what I deserve. When you get to the point where if I need bones on you, I am a sinner, and he is the Savior, now you're close enough to Jesus to actually become saved. In verse number 41, he said, we deserve this death. By the way, there's always payment due for sin. Always. Look at verse 41 also. Jesus did not die for himself, but verse 46. He was innocent. This means I'm coming for himself. We are. He's not. Well, what in the world is he doing up there on the cross? Well, first of all, remember, it was trumped up charges. Had to find some liars. They finally could stick to their lies. I thought, you know what's wrong with lying, among many other things? You got to remember all the lies that you fabricated so you can defend it when you're questioned, which is an impossibility. Because you can't base your next statement on facts. Liars are bad people. Very, very bad people. Verse number 42. He confessed that Jesus was the Lord. You read that here. And what he said was this. And he said unto him, Lord. Lord. You don't call somebody the Lord. That means it giving. He confessed he was a sinner. He confessed he was getting what he deserved. He was confessing that Jesus was innocent. He wasn't dying for himself. And then he confessed that he was the Lord. And then in verse number 42, he said, please take me to heaven with you. Do you remember the day you got saved? Has it become passé? Has it become known to you? Does it not mean anything anymore? Do you not go back and revisit that? Are you sure you got saved? Do you look at all this and go, okay, what time is it? We're getting ready to leave. You're in this crowd somewhere. We all are. We're all in this crowd somewhere. And by the way, Jesus promised to save him. He said, well, you know that? This day, not in the future, this day, thou shalt be with. That very day when Jesus died and was buried, he went to a place of paradise, Abraham's bosom. And collected all of those who were waiting on the literal resurrection. And guess who went with it? That faith. This day thou shalt be with me in paradise. says he led captivity captive. They were captive between a literal hell and heaven. They couldn't go either place. They believed in Jesus Christ and the blood from the Old Testament, but Jesus had not become the door yet, so they could not enter into heaven. They couldn't properly go to hell because they didn't believe in a Savior to come like we believe in a Savior that has come. So they went to a place called paradise, Abraham's bosom. And when Jesus died, he spent 3 days in the heart of the earth. Now, whether that means a lot of difference, but he went there and led them. Now we can go to heaven. Guess who was with him? Jesus always keeps his word. Does it make any difference what the world says? Make the world but give me Jesus. You know, folks, with all this pushing and shoving and political stuff and overthrowing and Antifa and BLM and White Lives Matter and Blue Lives Matter, whatever you call whatever you want to. You know, back in our day, we had hippies. Then we had yippies. Y'all don't remember that? You think I'm making this up? I'm not. It's as stupid as some of the things that we say we are today. Snowflake, that's a regional. Well, that might be, whatever. But we had pretty boys back in those days. There were faggots running around trying to pack like sissies. And the Bible said to avoid effeminates. Where do you fit in? Don't sidestep this. All of humanity was in this crowd somewhere. All of them. Everybody was watching. Everybody heard. Everybody was represented that day in that crowd somewhere. Will you be just a part of the crowd that watches and says nothing? You know what I'm saying to you, are you? You're going to change your mind. You've watched, heard, listened. I'm there, but I'm not about ready to move. Miss a part of the crowd. Number two, would you sit there on this Sunday, on this Lord's Day, as this event is spoken about? Snarl your lip, grin with contempt. You know you're raising Christ. If it were the best illustration. She begs that when you make a lot, then she came back and came here to think about this church. Will you show your disapproval by your expressions? Preacher, I never said one word against you. I know, here's what I'm getting. That's you. Or maybe you'll voice your opinion as you walk away from here. You'll be very rude about it. You don't care for this to you. See, you don't need this stuff. You don't know why you can't listen to me. It doesn't make any difference to you. You think how everything is fake and worthless. This whole, you know, this born again stuff. I don't know what that means. I don't need that stuff. I'm doing fine. Did you? Will you blaspheme the reputation of Jesus? By believing every false accusation you can find on the internet or from all your backslidden lost relatives and friends and saying, well, why did he come down to the cross? If he wasn't feeling anything because he was gone. But what did they do? It's going to turn out that way. You hate everything that you come up with. No truth to it any more than the Pharisees trying to say he's guilty. No, they all lied. They weren't trying to find out if he was innocent. They were trying to find something to murder him with. What are you doing? Doing this wrong somehow. Or, I pray, that's the other thing. Confessed, you're going to have to confess your sin. That's what he did. And you know you ought to pay for your sins. Come on. Even our human laws say you do this, you have to pay for it. You rack up your credit card, pay for it, quit trying to get out of it. why he had to die for me. Will you repent of your sin? The sin is not repent of all your sins. You don't even remember half of them anymore. You don't even know what true sins are anymore. The sin he's telling you to repent of is your sin of unbelief, of not receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior. That is the only sin that sends a person to hell. Jesus is the door to heaven. If you don't receive him, he's the door that stays shut. That is the worst sin you can commit. Because you can know it's only one person that you can do it. But you can get him. Will you blaspheme the reputation of Jesus? Or will you confess? Other great men's reasons. Even if you're on your deathbed, I wouldn't talk to them. I wouldn't let them know. But you know what comes time to do? I'll just ask Jesus to forgive me. First of all, that heart has been broken. Second of all, you don't know if you have time. What comes time to do? We had a guy here, his name was George Ferris. George Ferris was a huge rough guy. It's a man. Georgie said that in the apartment, we had six break-ins in a month of fasting. You want to know how to fix these doors? You already did that. Somebody took a crowbar and put those doors open. You already know that. They never tried to stop. So if you want to know what happened, somebody's doing this as well. And so, George, he got all upset. And so one of the guys, they went and ran out of the ditches with their AR-14 and stuff. George got a chair set in the middle of the parking lot. He kept watching. Okay, in the morning, he's asleep, the things are there. George loved this church. He loved the people. One day, George was waiting for the bus. George wrote a break in the morning. And he was waiting on the bus for a massive part of the funnel on his face. His bus sticker's face. The only person that crushed him for me anyway was allowed to be into the operating room that he was. And my poor father said, I had a girl in George for some sort of thing. And I was just breaking to the best of my abilities. And George was getting ready to take him to the doctor. He said, I'm coming here. I said, I've been told to you for a minute. I can't even remember. They were having a hard time. I'll be in jail instead of a little bit of my wife and folks will get ready to die. I'm going in. So that's against the law. No, it's against policy. There is no law that says I cannot go, but my heart goes down. That has bothered me to no end with Mrs. Myers and so many of you. And recently, I'm not even allowed to go to my house parties. It's like taking church away from Christians. The physical relationship is an absolute necessity for our existence. So, where do you fit in? Which one's you? You're either the tough guy, and I don't need this sissy stuff, I don't even want to go to church. You see, you feel like that. Maybe you're just a person that just come in, don't want to be noticed, and go back out. I just watch, I don't do anything about it. But, yes, I know Jesus died, but then there he is right there. I can see that. I've heard those stories, but I'm not going to do anything about it. Are you like one of the rulers? You just have to find an excuse to come in. You don't say anything. You know? That's not very popular, you know. So you just. That's you. Or you know you're deserving what's coming to you, but you're going to deflect that to somebody else. I'm going to speak to them. Yeah, church hurt me. That's why I'm not saved. I'm so fed up that that's what I'm calling it. It's not my fear. Some kid who grew up with a good mom and dad in a Christian home under a human preacher doing the best he could, and now you're going to use that as an excuse on why you don't have to live right. Don't talk to me at all about this. You have no excuse for it, sir. this story, you've seen this story, you were there, you're in this crowd somewhere. And I got to give up with you. Still frustrated about how things aren't fair. You're not right. Why do I have to believe? And then you have this guy right before you, some people have said, I deserve this kind of thing. I'm not under these things. And what if we're just remembering it when you come into the kingdom? He didn't get a chance to get baptized. Maybe baptism is a part of salvation. This guy could have been saved. Then people who don't know the Bible always say this. What would Jesus understand? What do you call that on your part? Baptism had nothing to do with salvation. Cleaning up your life has nothing to do with salvation. This man was hanging for capital punishment and said, I am guilty. And Jesus said, you to look at Jesus and you've heard the story and say, Jesus. That's the name. I'm going to go. I'm Jesus. You're going to decide this morning which one of those are you. Maybe you already have.